coming up on Path to Zero.
There's 135 renewable natural gas projects that are operational. We're developing a lot of new ones, and we're converting a lot of heavy-duty trucking fleets to use this rather than diesel.
Welcome to Path to Zero, the podcast about clean energy and the journey toward a low-carbon future. Your host is Tucker Perkins, engineer, entrepreneur, business leader, speaker, and clean energy industry veteran, who now serves as president and CEO of the Propane Education and Research Council. Now, here's Tucker.
Hello, Path to Zero listeners. You've tuned in for what is sure to be a fascinating episode. We have an opportunity to talk to the leaders of a 3.5-year-old company that's a pioneering force in the renewable energy sector. Adam Comora and Jonathan Maurer are the co-CEOs of OPAL Fuels, which creates renewable natural gas from decomposing organic material in landfills as well as dairies. We're going to explore how OPAL Fuels is setting itself apart in the renewable natural gas space and what makes their approach to combating climate change so effective. Adam and Jonathan, thanks for joining us and welcome to Path to Zero.
Thanks so much.
Thank you. Happy to be here.
We're going to talk a lot about OPAL, and I think we'll talk a lot about OPAL's business, but I think a great way to start this segment is by having you tell our listeners maybe what your company is doing. I like to hear a little bit about how you got to this space, but kind of start for us your personal journey and then the journey for OPAL in general.
Yeah, maybe I'll start with OPAL in general from the top, and then John can talk a little bit about our history. OPAL Fuels is a leader in capturing biomethane or biogas from decaying organic waste. We do that capturing organic materials when they're decomposing, create methane, which is one of the most harmful and damaging greenhouse gases. And it comes from a lot of different waste, whether it be landfills, animal waste, wastewater. And we're starting to look at food waste digestion, where if that methane from that organic material that's decomposing doesn't get captured, it vents off into the atmosphere. So OPAL Fuels has a long history capturing the methane from decaying organic waste and then creating either renewable electricity or what's really exciting is converting into renewable natural gas. And when we convert it into renewable electricity, it's a very attractive renewable electricity resource. It's baseload power. It runs 24/7. It's not intermittent from either wind or solar. It doesn't require battery storage. And it really provides a lot in terms of grid stability out there and gives us a low carbon electricity in a lot of areas that need it. When we find a project that is big enough and has proximity to an existing natural gas pipeline, we're able to purify that up into what is a natural gas substitute and then use it to decarbonize all sorts of difficult industries that are having difficulty decarbonizing. And where we're seeing the most success in that is using it as a transportation fuel and converting heavy-duty trucking fleets from diesel into renewable natural gas. And it's a wonderful drop-in renewable natural gas product in our existing pipelines. The technology is proven, it's cost-effective, and it's working. There's 135 renewable natural gas projects that are operational. We're developing a lot of new ones, and we're converting a lot of heavy-duty trucking fleets to use this rather than diesel. UPS is our largest customer. We've built 50 sites for them. They have 6,000 of their heavy-duty tractors that are running on this fuel every day. And there's a big opportunity to continue to do that, where renewable natural gas is currently servicing about 1.5% of the diesel fuel pool out there for heavy-duty trucking. So it's a really exciting time, and it's really a win-win kind of product. Not only are we capturing the harmful methane emissions at the source, but 30% of greenhouse gases in the U.S. come from the transportation sector. And there are all sorts of new EVs for passenger vehicles and that sort of thing. But we really haven't broken through on what to do with some more of these heavy industries. And this product is working well in heavy duty trucking.
So, Tucker, we started doing this about 25 years ago by aggregating small electric power generating facilities at landfills. And we built a portfolio of these over the course of the next 10 years or so. During that period, we were really looking at the renewable aspect or attributes of landfill gas to electricity at the time. And we started looking at downstream fueling as well, and putting natural gas into trucks, which can be at a discount to diesel. When diesel prices are high, natural gas prices tend to be lower, and the replacing a diesel engine with a CNG engine gives a truck a very similar feel to a diesel truck. And so as we started looking at moving into transportation, building station, servicing those stations that we build, that's when we started to move into RNG. And instead of just doing the electric power, which we'd done for the previous 15 to 20 years, we started moving into RNG. We've been doing RNG now since 2019 or so, and that's really where our growth is. We work with landfill companies to use that biogas that comes from the landfills. It can also be done at dairies with cow manure. It can be done wastewater facilities, as Adam said, with digesting food waste as well. And then you upgrade that gas by pulling out the CO2, nitrogen, oxygen, sulfur, other things that are not natural gas methane. And you have this 98 to 100% pure product that you can then inject into our national natural gas pipeline system and utilize anywhere across the U.S. in difficult to decarbonize industries.
Are you beginning to think about other fuels beyond RNG? I'm thinking hydrogen or something. Are you just clearly focused right now on renewable natural gas?
Yeah, that's a good question, Tucker. And you know, the really interesting thing about the product that we create is that it is available for a myriad of industry and industrial applications. We can take our renewable natural gas and actually create renewable hydrogen for it. We are not getting into the hydrogen production aspect of it, but we can use our RNG as a feedstock to create renewable hydrogen. You know, a lot of folks are looking at sustainable aviation fuel and whether or not they can take RNG and turn it into a sustainable aviation fuel. Those feel like they're going to be a little bit further off into the future, but it's certainly an opportunity. Right now, our core business and our core focus is capturing biogas and converting it into a low carbon intensity energy, either renewable power or renewable natural gas. And but there are a lot of burgeoning new industries. Marine fuel is one that we think is going to be really interesting, where you can take renewable natural gas and turn it into renewable methanol. And there's a lot of ships that are starting to use renewable methanol or methanol as a bunker fuel. You know, we do see those other new markets, and you can also export it as liquefied natural gas or renewable methanol and brought over to Europe or Asia or other places.
And so the one knock that I hear often about a whole bunch of renewable fuels is just feedstock availability. And I know you've talked quite openly about you have landfills, which are quite numerous, and most of them probably don't have a solution for capturing their methane. You've talked a lot about dairy, and I generally think it also goes to feedlot cattle as well, right? I know a little bit about hog and swine. Then you talked about food waste as a new source, but even if you aggregate all of that, do you tend to worry about having enough feedstock available for your market demand?
Well, we'll be able to grow substantially as an industry from where we are today. As Adam mentioned before, heavy-duty trucking, for example, is 44 billion gallons a year of diesel. And we, as an industry, are producing about 1.5% of that fuel. if, you know, we have ability to grow 6 to 10 times where we are today over the next 5 to 10 years. And so, again, not going to serve the entire heavy duty fleet with renewable natural gas, but enough to make a dent. You mentioned before about hydrogen, and I'll just say that there are many different solutions that can be used, and we're not going to be the only solution. But right now, we are an economic and viable solution. We can provide decarbonization at a discount to diesel so that fleets can save money, reduce their overall costs of fuel, cost of ownership, cost of transportation, and do it with while decarbonizing.
Yeah, I would just follow up there too, Tucker, is that it is such a wonderful solution that we're doing because we are eliminating those methane emissions at the source. You know, there's not going to be one silver bullet, right, that can take all diesel off the road or decarbonize everything. And to John's point, you know, if the industry captured all the biogas that was out there, maybe we could get up to about 25% of converting diesel over. And then there will be other solutions that are going to be required. In terms of feedstock, though, a really nice feature of the industry that we play in is that it's stable, it's recurring, and we know where it's coming from. You know, these landfills are very predictable. We've been doing this for a long period of time, and all the RNG facilities that we build are on open and growing landfills that are still accepting trash. So, you know, we feel really confident that our feedstock continues to grow at our existing sites, and there are a lot of new opportunities to continue to deploy, you know, RNG projects across the industry. One other thing I would say to your energy listeners, one other very interesting thing about our industry and our feedstock is it doesn't require any capital to produce our fuel. After we develop a project and put a well field in place at these landfills, they do not require additional capital expenditures. After we build our facilities, what you're doing is dropping PVC pipes into a landfill. They have perforations. You hook them all up together and you just apply a little bit of suction that brings all the methane gas to one processing facility. So after we build these facilities, they don't require additional capital expenditures. And we have, you know, minimum of 20-25 year mineral rights or gas rights when we partner with municipalities and landfills. And after we build these facilities, all the cash flows that we generate are really free cash flow.
Yeah, it's an awesome story. So let's talk a little bit about one thing that fascinates me, because you, to your point, you bring, and you mentioned UPS, and I'm glad to hear, I think you said as many as 6,000 road tractors today operating on renewable natural gas. And UPS is a wonderful success story, but you've already said you bring environmental benefits. You bring really no degradation in power. I'm sure those engines are quieter. I mean, every benefit accrues. And lastly, so not only better for the environment, better for the driver, but better for the CFO, because you're bringing to them a lower cost. Why do you think heavy-duty trucking tends to be so averse to leaving diesel?
Tucker, you're previewing a magic wand question, because I read Bill Gates's book on how to avoid a climate disaster, and there's a whole chapter on a green discount product, and why does it exist? And we really think it's education. And we also have some advocacy work to be done in DC. It's a great question, Tucker. And I really believe it comes down to education and just explaining to these Class 8 heavy duty fleets that there's a product available today, and there's a new Cummins 15 liter engine that's been introduced, which we think is really going to jumpstart fleet adoption and demand. I just feel like certain industries are a little reluctant to do things differently. A lot of those transportation and trucking firms don't feel either the pain or the benefit in fluctuating diesel prices because of the way they price through their transportation services, where fuel is a surcharge when it goes through. It really has to do with education, that there's something out there that can be done today and work for them. And, we're hopeful we're going to be successful in that education, that there is this viable green discount product.
You just feel like there's such a competitive advantage, because if you could offer a product better for the environment, better for your labor, better for your mechanics, better for a community, and by the way, it was cheaper then, it's just a compelling story, and one I see routinely. I'm on the other end of that a lot with not class 8, but class 7, with a lot of those same features and benefits. So you've teased us out for a magic wand, and we'll wait happily for that question. All right, let's talk a little bit about your downstream business, because I think, always looking at ways that I think OPAL is unique from some of the other players in this space, but clearly one place you are unique is your downstream business. You do the design, the construction, you operate the facility. So talk a little bit about your downstream philosophy.
Yeah, it's another good question. And we think it is a little bit unique and sets us apart from our competition. When we thought about converting our landfill gas to electricity portfolio into RNG and accessing the transportation fuel offtake market, we found that there were a lot of strategic and financial reasons why it was important to have the marketing and distribution. And if you think about it, it's really like that old school energy philosophy where you own the mineral rights or develop the resource. We have the refining capacity that sits where those biogas emissions come from. And then we've also got the retail and marketing distribution where we're selling the fuel directly to heavy duty fleets. So that vertical integration allows us to have a significant strategic advantage. For our landfill or feedstock host partners, the transportation fuel market is much more valuable than other places where you can sell your RNG. And that's predominantly because of the renewable fuel standard here in the U.S. When we produce our RNG and place it into a vehicle, we're able to sell environmental credits that get created by the renewable fuel standard and allow us to achieve pricing of $35 to $40 per MMBTU for our renewable natural gas. In order to create those credits, you need to have both the production of the RNG and also the station that you are fueling a truck. That's what you send into your EPA to create those credits. If we didn't have that downstream dispensing capacity, there's economic leakage and friction between the producer and the distributor and seller of that fuel. So we thought it was really important. Also, having access to the transportation fuel market and the highest value end product, we're a much more attractive company for a landfill owner to work with, to know that they're going to get the highest value of the product because we can place it directly into vehicles through our station network and dispensing network. On the fleet side of things, as they are continuing to think about how do they achieve and reduce their scope 1 and scope 2 emissions, from where they're sitting with diesel, and we'll see when the SEC comes out or financial disclosures are requiring your scope 1 and scope 2 emissions. When you use RNG as a transportation fuel, you record 0 scope 1 and 0 scope 2 emissions, a very powerful product at that financial discount to diesel. By having our own production capacity, we can guarantee those fleets that they will be getting RNG for their trucks. So we really see it on both sides of our business, how it is a strategic advantage. And then financially, we're keeping the full value of the molecule by owning it all the way through production to distribution.
In addition to the vertical integration, our 25 plus year history in the industry and using proven technology with a group of professionals with a focus on excellence and relationships really differentiates us as well.
Yeah, we really got into that downstream marketing and distribution business about 13 years ago, where we purchased a company that was building and designing fuel stations. It was a small company. There were about 12 employees. They were building 5 stations a year. We really got excited, not only for the RNG aspect of it, but we actually think natural gas as a substitute to diesel makes financial sense. And there were a lot of people Clean Energy is a public company that's building out fueling stations on the downstream side. You know, a lot of folks looked at this industry and thought it made economic sense when you could turn natural gas into an oil substitute, because natural gas is so plentiful and cheap here in the U.S. versus oil, which is really a global commodity. You know, we think there were, and so some folks were just focused on the downstream piece of it to convert, you know, diesel over to regular natural gas or fossil natural gas. And then there were some folks that were approaching the industry just on the upstream side to build RNG facilities. And pretty early on, we really got excited and thought about this vertical integration model for those reasons that we talked about.
And interesting to me, you really started landfill gas to power. I mean, if we go back almost two decades, you were predominantly landfill gas to power. And now as I listen to you talk and really think about the future, you're almost now, I won't say exclusively because I don't believe you are, but you're predominantly thinking about landfill gas to diesel substitute for, we'll call it hard to decarbonize, but at the end of the day, it's mainly Class 8 trucking right now. That why have you made that shift? As the conversation is all around electricity and the need for more and more of it, why are you thinking now about Class 8 trucking?
Policy.
Yeah, and I would say this, Tucker. We are not only thinking about RNG, and we are getting out there with the messaging that it is, we think there is an enormous opportunity for renewable power from biogas. Not every biogas emission source is large enough or has proximity to a pipeline to justify building an RNG facility. Those are very they cost anywhere from $50 million up to $100 million to build, and you need a large biogas resource in order to justify building an RNG facility. We are extremely interested, enthusiastic, optimistic that there is going to be additional focus on smaller biogas emission sources for renewable power generation. And we think that there is going to be a new push to be able to capture those smaller sites and develop new renewable electricity facilities. So, you know, we've started, you know, over the last several years, we've been and the next several, we'll be investing a lot of capital in those new RNG production facilities, but we see a new wave coming of those renewable electricity facilities at these smaller sources. And there's a couple of specific things that we think, you know, could happen in the short term, but we do believe that will happen as well.
You know, during the 90s and 2000s, the policy towards reducing greenhouse gases really promoted renewable energy credits. And that was a value that was given to renewable electricity. So our focus was really on developing renewable electricity that could generate these renewable energy credits. During the 2010s, policy shifted to really start to promote transportation fuel. You saw it federally with the renewable fuel standard. We saw it with ethanol. We saw it with renewable diesel. Now we see renewable natural gas. And so you see that policy developing in terms of promoting these. And that's when we really focused on pushing really into the transportation sector. We believe that policy will continue to develop and will again promote this collection of renewable, of fugitive methane, to create renewable natural gas or renewable electricity. And that will again develop the renewable electricity industry in the future and those smaller landfills that Adam was mentioning.
Jonathan, let me stay with you on that for one more question, because I'm always, whenever anybody says in the, use some historical reference, you said in, I'll start with, you said in the 1990s. So I'm fascinated that so many people in the view today are, seem to be intolerant of solutions that may be 5 or 10 years in the rearview mirror. They only believe in solutions that aren't even real today. I'm thinking about hydrogen. I'm thinking about fusion. I'm thinking about all what we tend to refer as shiny new technologies that may or may not even get to the market. But if they get to the market, it certainly is not in a decade called the 2020s. It would be much later. How do you promote yourself as a serious answer to a climate problem when you're so burdened by being able to go back and talk about the 1990s? How do you cast yourself as forward thinking when you're so ancient history?
Well, I don't feel that it's a burden at all. Again, we've seen over the course of the last two decades and more, this increasing focus on collecting methane. Methane, as Adam said earlier, is one of the most harmful greenhouse gases out there, and it's quite plentiful waste methane. And if we can increase our use of that waste methane, look, it's being created every day by the trash that we put into landfills and by the manure and food waste and other things that we throw away or otherwise waste. And so when we capture this and use it productively in making electricity or in making transportation fuel or other difficult to decarbonize industries, we're making a double-barreled impact on reducing greenhouse gases by capturing that methane and displacing diesel, fossil fuels. So this is, I think, something that was trending a decade or two ago, is trending today, and will trend further in the coming decade or two as well. We feel that we're well positioned as a company to take advantage of that and to be not the solution, but a solution.
Yeah, and I would also think about it this way, Tucker, in terms of I believe, will always be trying to capture these waste methane emissions. And so when you're talking about the new shiny objects, I think you're really talking about, what are we going to do with it? We happen to believe heavy duty trucking is a practical application that's working today and continue to work in the future to take diesel off the road. But when you're talking about those shiny new objects, you're really talking about what we should be doing with the methane after we capture it. We believe that there will continue to be support publicly and in policy to be doing all that we can to capture these methane emissions. So I don't see that going away by shiny new objects. We do hear about all the shiny new objects about what we should be doing with it, which from our perspective doesn't always make the most pragmatic or logical sense when there's policy saying, hey, you know, rather than doing heavy duty trucking, let's move off of that and think about SAF or hydrogen or something else, which we can discuss and debate. And that's what we do in our education and advocacy. But we don't believe that those shiny new objects replace capturing methane emissions.
Great answers. And I love that. I think I'm completely in your camp and in agreement that you already said there's 40 plus billion gallons of diesel consumed in on-road trucking. And there's another 20 billion or so consumed in off-road applications. And I look forward a decade. It shouldn't be like that. It should be renewable fuels for sure. All right. Well, let's have a little fun here. Let's give you the magic wand. I've kind of been, ever since you teased it, Adam, I've kind of been listening. So maybe I want you to go last. Jonathan, let me ask you, we're going to hand you a magic wand. We're going to give you a chance to change one thing in the next 1 year regarding climate change, sustainability overall. Jonathan, how would you use that magic wand?
I would look for the federal government to provide a policy incentive to collect this fugitive methane gas from landfills and from other sources. And I see that as something that could promote perhaps like making renewable electricity for electric vehicles or other policy promoting collecting that gas and providing incentives for it, rather than some sort of disincentive or penalty for producing the methane. There should be incentive for collecting it. And that's what I'd like to see. I think it would go a very, very long way towards reducing greenhouse gas emissions and would promote our business.
Great use of the wand. Adam, what do you say?
Well, John and I are typically aligned, both in terms of our value system and how we view the world. So I'm just going to expand a little bit on it because it is you know, a similar kind of thought where, you know, it's really interesting where, you know, we see two sides of the debate, which is, you know, a lot of times progressive climate folks are really focused on electrons, because when you use electricity, there are obviously no emissions. We still have a lot of advocacy and education work to be done on the progressive side of climate action, that, you know, we have a waste in place molecule issue, and we should be doing everything that we can to incentivize its capture and also promote its productive use in the most pragmatic sense. And you know, there are times where, you know, the blue side of things puts up or thinks that all molecules are bad, because there will be some combustion at some point, or not happy with the way pipelines are monitoring or measuring their methane emissions. And on the red side of things, you know, they're sometimes feeling like we don't want to incentivize electrons, or, you know, not supportive of what John had just mentioned, the use of renewable electricity as a transportation fuel. And my magic wand would be, you know, we think of ourselves, OPAL, our color is purple. We really think it's bipartisan, you know, sort of blue and red merged together. So my magic wand would be that we should be embracing a better, best strategy, which is we should be collecting all the biomethane or biogas that we can, and we should be either producing renewable electricity, which again is all those positive things in these rural and ag communities and municipalities that own these facilities to create grid stability and good baseload renewable power. And we should be embracing RNG where we can, which are molecules for those hard to decarbonize sectors, whether it be heavy duty trucking or potentially marine fuel or other types of applications. So my magic wand is, you know, making all the folks in DC and across the country understand that climate change is a bipartisan issue, right? And the capturing of this biogas and doing what we can with it should be broadly supported, rather than be fixated on either the molecule side or the electron side.
Great uses of the wand, and I wish both of you the best of luck in using that wand and getting that wish, because I think it'd be good for all of us. I mean, to your point that you've made over and over, capturing methane that's happening anyway, right? If we do nothing, we literally are doing nothing. The methane goes. So I know you refer to it often as win, 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 but it's good for the environment, good for the communities, and good for the end user as well.
And this is also not new taxpayer dollars. These are existing programs and existing laws that exist, the renewable fuel standard. So we just want to have consistent application of the renewable fuel standard, regardless of who's in the White House, and also be true to its original intent, which is to grow cellulosic biofuels, and renewable electricity is being used as a transportation fuel.
Well said. All right, let's have one more piece of fun, and I think I know where both of you are today, but we love to plant a tree in a national forest in recognition of the time you spent with us today, the expertise you shared with us, and really kind of a nice way to start a relationship that lasts a long time. So I'll start with you, Adam. Where would you like to see a tree planted in your name?
Oh my gosh. Well, I should have looked up what the National Forest is called, but all my kids went to summer camp in Maine. Arcadia National Forest would be terrific. We've had a lot of positive experiences in Maine.
You know, I was
great choice.
Acadia also, it's really a very underappreciated national park. It is the largest national park in our country. And because it's on the East Coast, most people think of national parks as being kind of a Western phenomenon, but it's really amazing. But I'm going to go a little bit off beat here, having spent most of my life in New York State. I'm going to pick a state park, not a national park, and go with it, the Adirondack State Park in New York.
Well, Russ loves the research and then loves the actual effort. So I was thinking you were going to make it easy for him by giving him the same park in Maine, but he's happier that you've given him a dual task. So we will look forward to honoring both of you, one in Maine and one in New York. Thank you very much. Okay. All right, let's wrap up. You know, we didn't talk a lot about OPAL, and I encourage people to look at it, but what would you like to tell us that we haven't asked?
Well, first off, the vertical integration is really important. Again, capturing that value chain, being able to give our fleet customers the commitment of the upstream RNG and being able to give our landfill owners the commitment of that transportation fuel value. The fact that we've been doing this for over 25 years, that we use proven technology and we build projects that work, both the RNG collection and electricity projects, as well as the fueling stations for downstream fleet customers. We have a high degree of efficiency, availability, and we're really relationship focused.
Yeah, the only thing I would add there is we've been doing this a long time, and that we've got a really experienced management team and really feel good about our position as a leader in this space. And this is not a science experiment where we're trying to build it and see if it's going to work. This is proven technology. We have robust cash flows and a really good positive growth outlook for continuing to grow OPAL Fuels. And we are also focused on maximizing shareholder value. You know, we still are, our parent company that we spun out of is still the largest shareholder of OPAL Fuels. And we think we've really got a good opportunity to grow and, you know, not only do good for the environment, but also feel good about where we sit for our shareholders and investors.
Well, and I'll give you a plug, you know, public company, it's nice to be able to go through and look sometimes at the transparency a public company brings. So the website is OPAL Fuels, I believe, opalfuels.com, right?
Yes, sir.
And the stock symbol is OPAL, O-P-A-L.
That's
so, correct. Jonathan and Adam, thank you so much for being with us on Path to Zero.
Thank you, Tucker.
Thank you. Enjoyed it, Tucker.
We appreciate the opportunity to learn more about OPAL Fuels' efforts in the energy transition. Thank you for joining us on Path to Zero. And for all our listeners, we'll see you next time.
Thank you for listening to Path to Zero with Tucker Perkins. If you like what you've heard, subscribe and rate us on your favorite podcast app. You can email us with questions or comments to pathtozero@propane.com.